Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Louis Friedberg, senior reporter with California Watch, and your moderator for the program. This program is being held in association with the Commonwealth Club's Inforum division. It is now my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Joss Silver, President and CEO of the Free Press, who will be discussing the future of journalism and internet access. Joss Silver is the President and CEO of Free Press, an eight-year-old national nonprofit organization working to reform the media. Through education, organizing, and advocacy, it is working to promote diverse and independent media ownership, strong public media, quality journalism, and universal access to communications. Josh was previously campaign manager for the successful Clean Elections in Arizona ballot initiative there, and director of development for the cultural arm of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. He has published widely on media, telecommunications, campaign finance, and other public policy issues. Please welcome Josh Silver.
Thank you, Louis. Thanks, everybody, for coming tonight, and thanks, television and radio viewers and listeners. I want to start by thanking the Commonwealth Club and George for inviting me to speak tonight. I'm truly honored to speak at such a venerated institution. I saw the list of people who have spoken before, and I almost just decided not to come and cower behind a bush somewhere. I'm here to tell you a fascinating story, and it has all the trappings of one of those page-turner paperbacks that you read on vacation. It has money, power, political scandal. Only this story is real, it's happening now, and it is the final chapter, in the end, it's gonna determine the future of our democracy. I'm gonna start with a real story back in 1995, and I'm 26 years old. I'm traveling in the Amazon River Basin in South America. I'm with one of my best friends named Patchen Miller. We were longtime travel companions and fellow adventurers. By the time we decided to float the headwaters of the Amazon, Patchen had already spent most of his very short life doing community service. We built a large wooden raft, and we prepared for a 1 or 2 month float down the river. We didn't know how long it would take. 3 days into the trip, we were ambushed. Patchen was shot and killed, and I was shot and left for dead. It's a true story. After a harrowing week-long odyssey, I reached Peru's capital. 7 pieces of lead were removed from my leg. The doctor kept saying, mucho suerte, very lucky, as the lead was about an inch from my leg, the artery in my leg. I came home with a powerful sense of how short and fragile this life is. I understood at a young age the importance of using my brief time on this earth wisely to do the greatest good possible. And I came home searching for the most efficient, effective way to do that. That search led me to one of the 2 most critical issues facing our country, a quiet cancer that has spread from Washington across the nation, and if it's not stopped, I believe will destroy this amazing experiment we call the United States. After 40 years of brilliant and well-financed organizing, the political machine in Washington representing the interests of corporate and economic elites has achieved near complete control of American political discourse and policymaking. This is not a theory or opinion, this is a fact. The final blow came just over a year ago when the Supreme Court ruled in the Citizens United case that corporate funding of independent political broadcasts in elections cannot be limited under the First Amendment. That ruling has allowed an explosion of special interest spending, which was already at record levels, to soar into the stratosphere. New super PACs now take unlimited amounts of corporate money and explicitly call for the election or defeat of political candidates. Today, corporate lobbyists regularly and legally go into politicians' offices and threaten to spend millions of dollars if he or she doesn't vote with that industry. This kind of threat used to be unique to gangsters and thugs, and it has now become the status quo in Washington. Only today, instead of pushing gambling or drug cartels, the thugs are killing affordable health care, regulations that prevent financial meltdowns, and protections against global warming. The list goes on. The cancer is spreading quickly, and it marks the end of the romantic vision of America that we learned about as kids. The sweet story of a vibrant, healthy democracy, of voters that matter, of founding fathers who fought and died to ensure that decisions would not be made by monarchs or oligarchs. Before Citizens United, the US political system was already a case study in the unholy alliance between economic elites and politics. After major public interest victories under FDR, and again in the 1960s and 1970s under Presidents Johnson and Nixon, industry and economic elites began building an elaborate infrastructure of influence that has grown and improved over time. They understood that reasonable regulatory oversight and progressive taxation posed a threat to their bottom line. An army of lobbyists, think tanks, PR shops, corporate-friendly media outlets, political attack groups, where they were all born and they were nurtured. Thousands of former politicians and government employees with golden Rolodexes and unparalleled access became industry's emissaries in the halls of power. The fight in Washington is often painted as an epic battle between conservatives and liberals, but in truth, it has nothing to do with left and right. It is about the largest corporations and the wealthiest Americans and their unstoppable lobbying infrastructure and campaign contributions manipulating public opinion and writing laws that increase profits and avoid taxation while destroying the very fabric of a functional economy and society. That's a mouthful. They skillfully promote the false left-right frame to discredit critics, confuse, polarize, and compel ordinary Americans to fight each other instead of the real problem. They fight to protect hedge fund tycoons' 15% tax loophole, while the gap between America's rich and poor grows greater than at any time since the Great Depression. They fight pharmaceutical price controls that would allow sick, poor people to have medicine. They fight against living wages that would lift millions out of poverty. They fight clean air and clean water. They fight anything and everything that might reduce profits, no matter the cost to our society and our sanity. And they are so powerful that no matter how much public support an issue enjoys, no matter how much, it ends up either as a watered-down half measure or is blocked outright while its proponents are painted as raving socialists. Watching this cancer overtake our government, the people's government, leaves me with many of the same feelings of grief that I felt when the disease took my mother's life last year. A deep, abiding fear, compounded by the joy and innocence of my beautiful 18-month-old daughter. How will her life be if we don't fix this? I wish I had an answer to that question, but I don't. So I'm going to ask you guys another. Let's say for a moment that we could fix this problem of corporate and elite control of Washington. Let's say for a moment that we could reform the political system and make it so that people and not industry control government. What good is a reformed political system if the people don't know what's going on? What good is it if they're not sufficiently exposed to critical journalism and fact-based information? What happens if the public gets their information from a media system mired in mind-numbing sensationalism, celebrity, partisan shouting matches, and a political culture obsessed with soundbites, personalities, horse races, and profit, instead of substance and the relentless pursuit of the truth? The answer is the sister issue to the corporate control of government. It is the other critical issue and the subject of today's talk. U.S. media are shedding journalists en masse, replacing expensive critical reporting with ever-thinning newspapers, profitable but polarizing television and radio opinion shows, superficiality, and bellowing talking heads. In its wake is a breathtakingly uninformed and propagandized citizenry. Vulnerable to the most Orwellian manipulations by ideologues, public relation firms, and campaign operatives, politicians and industries with the biggest money to buy advertisements, PR firms, attack groups, and think tanks win hearts, minds, and votes. The Pew Center for People and the Press reports that despite the rise of the internet, the vast majority of Americans still get their news and information from commercial television. And if you've watched it lately or listened to commercial radio, you know why our national discourse and our politics have sunk so low. There is little room for journalism in the profit-crazed entertainment industry that is commercial TV and radio. What about those weapons of mass destruction? Where were the stories about the real estate bubble before the meltdown? When's the last time a major commercial television or radio network did a substantive story on Egypt before the protests began to give us context and substance? When's the last time there was a story about the status quo corruption that is Washington? Sure, they'll cover casino Jack Abramoff and a congressman who puts bundles of cash in his freezer, but the real story that no one is telling is what is legal. The real story is what Chris Hedges calls the dead hand of corporate power that is rapidly transforming the United States into a feudal state. And when we turn to the place where most actual news is gathered, we find newspapers in a well-documented and rapid decline. As advertising revenues move to the web, print and delivery costs increase, and slash and burn owners sacrifice reporters' jobs at the altar of profit-making. The number of journalists covering state houses has decreased by 31% in the past decade. Testifying in front of the U.S. Congress last year, David Simon, creator of The Wire television show and a former journalist, somberly proclaimed, "The next 10 to 15 years will be halcyon days for local corruption. It's going to be a great time to be a corrupt politician." And while there's encouraging local online news operations springing up in San Diego, Minneapolis, Austin, and here in the Bay Area with people like Lewis, there is little reason to believe that these fine projects will be duplicated in the thousands of communities that desperately need journalism. Such projects take generous local philanthropy combined with strong executive and editorial talent, a rare combination. Beyond the crisis of content that I just described, a quieter, equally dangerous crisis faces our 21st century distribution platform called the internet. It is the most exciting communications tool in modern history. Its potential cannot be overstated. It allows us to access and share information in ways hard to imagine just 15 years ago. Its light speed transcends geography and time itself. Its two-way capacity makes us active participants. It is fostering positive and social and political movements around the world. It's a huge engine for economic growth. And in the next few years, as speeds increase and technology improves, all media, television, radio, phone service, emerging technologies we haven't even dreamed of, will be delivered by a high-speed internet connection. Computers, televisions, radios, and telephones are merging into the same device. Think about what a game changer this is. Anybody's website could become a television or radio network, breaking open access and distribution of media content. The cost of distribution plummets. Independent, non-commercial voices that have been unable to find a home on cable television or broadcast dials finally have equal footing. Witness the most promising information revolution of our time. But the same corrupt policymaking that has ceded control of our government to K Street lobbyists has put the brilliant potential of internet in grave danger. Phone, cable, and broadcast lobbyists, second in Washington spending only to the pharmaceutical industry, have pressured pliant politicians into actively preventing competition amongst internet service providers like phone and cable companies. leaving 97% of Americans with two or fewer choices for providers. Now, so what, right? If you have a choice between a Ford and a Chevy and no other cars, is that a competitive auto market? The internet provider competition problem has driven up costs and driven down speeds, with the U.S. plummeting from 4th to 22nd compared to other countries in speed and adoption in the past decade. But don't expect the Federal Communications Commission, the federal agency charged with protecting the public interest, to help. Last month, it caved to K Street lobbyists and their puppets in Congress, passing a loophole-ridden rule that would allow phone companies to censor and control the wireless web, slowing down or blocking internet content at will. Competition and consumer choice be damned. Rules affecting wireline connections were a bit better, but still riddled with loopholes. This despite President Obama's promise to take a backseat to no one on net neutrality. The next domino fell soon after, when Comcast, the largest cable television and residential high-speed internet provider, was allowed by government regulators to merge last week with programming giant NBC Universal, marking a new kind of what's called vertical media integration. Comcast will point to so-called conditions of the deal applied that prevent the scenario I describe, but they fail to mention that those conditions expire after 7 years. For Comcast, this is a short time to wait before they can have their way. What was created last week is a massive company that owns the distribution network, the wires, and one of the nation's largest content providers. These are two companies that used to and are supposed to engage in hard-nosed negotiations with each other. No longer. The deal allows Comcast to move online video that is currently free behind a paywall. They will now raise prices for NBC content to other cable and satellite providers and innovators like Netflix and Hulu.com. Every American will end up paying more and have fewer choices. And we'll soon see a merger wave with companies like AT&T or Time Warner trying to keep up by acquiring CBS or Disney. 2 years before his administration blessed the Comcast-NBC merger, candidate Barack Obama said, "I strongly favor the diversity of ownership of outlets and protection against excessive concentration of power in the hands of one corporation, interest, or small group," unquote. Another campaign promise broken at the hands of K Street lobbyists. It doesn't have to be this way. I believe in capitalism. I'm fine with NBC Universal being sold, but it is the role of government to ensure that it's done in a way that does not hurt the American people. It is the role of government to put the interests of the people ahead of lobbyists. But that is not the case in modern Washington. And if you make such a claim, if you suggest that NBC should be sold to a different company, if you suggest that the largest internet providers should not be allowed to indiscriminately block or slow down content on the internet in order to maximize profits, if you suggest that insurance and big pharma shouldn't write the healthcare law, if you suggest that Exxon and Chevron shouldn't dictate environmental policy, you will be attacked by a guerrilla army of PR shops and political mercenaries. You will be called a socialist or a radical. You will see your position contorted with no deference to the actual truth. It happens to every one of us on the national level who confronts Washington's elite corporate complex. And it gets worse. As we look towards the internet's future, more dark clouds are gathering. In a few years, high-speed broadband access will be controlled by the cable industry. What does that mean? As the internet delivers more high-definition television, gaming, telemedicine, and other high-bandwidth content, cable internet providers will soon be the only ones with wires fast enough to handle the increased load. Phone companies' DSL service will be too slow. And companies like AT&T and Verizon have just canceled plans to lay high-speed fiber to compete with cable. Before the rise of the elite corporate complex, this would have been an easy fix. Previous monopolies like railroads, oil, they were broken up by government regulators because of clear and obvious harms to the public interest. But today, it's different. Today, President Obama's much-touted national broadband plan doesn't even touch the broadband problem. It's the third rail issue for AT&T, Verizon, and Comcast, so it's a third rail issue for Democrats and Republicans and the majority of Congress. Only what's at stake here isn't pork bellies or corn. What's at stake here is the information system central to a functional democratic system. Is all lost? Is it possible to put this genie back in the bottle? I think national crises facing our nation, corporate control of government, and the lack of an informed electorate, there are two primary reform strategies that can and must succeed in order for these United States to survive. We must make the corporate takeover of government a bona fide political issue in America. We must relentlessly expose the quid pro quo of money and political favors and paint corrupt politicians with a scarlet letter of shame in their home districts. We must create real political pain for anyone who chooses corporate benefactors over his or her constituents. At the same time, we must advance a broad range of pro-democracy reforms, campaign finance reform, universal voter registration, redistricting reform, election integrity, constitutional amendments that affirm corporations do not enjoy the same First Amendment rights as people, and that money does not equal speech. Senate filibuster and electoral college reform, instant runoff voting, proportional representation, and more transparency. These issues must be placed upon a political chessboard and played with more strategic precision by the skilled advocates who are tired of being taken down by corporate lobbyists. On the informed citizenry issue, there are two fronts for reform that mirror the two major problems, infrastructure and content. In order to ensure fast, affordable, uncensored internet for every American, we must engage in the wonky but crucial policy fights for internet service provider competition and net neutrality rules that prevent ISPs from turning the internet into cable television. We must secure large swaths of the public airwaves for new wireless ISPs to compete and for innovators to thrive. We must act as vigilant watchdogs, calling out companies that break the law or rip off consumers. Taken together, these fights lead the way to open, universally accessible communications for every American. On the content side, we will surely need to rely on old-fashioned American innovation. I think Lewis represents that with some of the projects he's done, and there are thousands like him across the country. But there is a hard reality that we can't ignore. With the divorce of advertising and news content brought by the rise of the internet, there's simply not enough money in the form of advertising, subscriptions, and philanthropy to support the depth and breadth of journalism that is necessary, especially for local and international reporting. With this in mind, the most promising solution is to bolster non-commercial public media. Currently, our public broadcasting system is among the lowest funded per capita in the developed world, receiving less than $2 per taxpayer per year. Compare that to Denmark at over $100 or England at over $80. More public funding for public media will surely require improvements to the current system. A stronger firewall must be created to protect it from undue political pressure. Public funding must be increased without relying on annual congressional appropriations. We must expand the tent so that a broader range of independent media, including ventures like the Bay Area News Project and others like the MinnPost and the Texas Tribune, could receive public funds. We must diversify the age, class, and race of audience and content. And we must improve the leadership, performance, and infrastructure across public media. If you're shaking your head and thinking that government has no role in journalism or media, you're ignoring the facts. Here are the facts. A study by The Economist magazine concludes that the world's healthiest democracies also enjoy the best funded public media systems. A fresh study from New York University's Professor Rod Benson just out last month looked at 14 public media systems around the world funded at $30 to $134 per capita, much higher than ours, and found that all, quote, provide more and higher quality public affairs programming and a greater diversity of genre and unique perspectives than their commercial counterparts. The reality is this: there is no other viable economic model or institution capable of filling the news void, and empirical proof from around the world shows it's the right solution. Now, I realize that in these last 28 minutes, I've hit you with a lot of ideas. So I'm going to leave you with this. Our government and our nation, I believe, is in serious trouble. The supremacy of the elite corporate complex has put the gap between the rich and poor at levels that are not sustainable. K Street lobbyists prevent reforms to every issue that face natural industry opposition. Americans have access to plenty of media noise, but not enough critical, hard-hitting journalism. And things will get worse unless we rethink our priorities and focus the bulk of our philanthropic and advocacy resources on the root of the problem that I've described. These issues are decidedly nonpartisan. They're hurting Americans, both liberal and conservative. Reform efforts must embrace and engage everyone, from the most lefty activists here in San Francisco to the most conservative Tea Party members in the Bible Belt. These issues also do not feature polar bears sinking on icebergs. They don't have natural disaster victims. They are cerebral, and they require a logic chain to understand how they are the reforms that make every other reform possible. As such, they play poorly in the reptilian dance of American media and politics, but they can and will resonate with the right messages and a big tent approach that embraces the widest range of stakeholders from every place in the political spectrum. If I have provided the logic chain to just one or two of you tonight, if I have convinced you that these two issues are the fights of our lives, then I have lived up to the decision I made when I returned from my terrifying journey to Peru. I have succeeded in what has become the Paul Revere moment of our times. Only this time, the enemy isn't coming. It's already here. It has taken the Capitol. It must be driven out. And it will take all of us in this room, everyone listening to this broadcast, and many, many more across the country to succeed. Nothing less than our future depends on it. Thank you.
Our thanks to Josh Silver, President and CEO of the Free Press. And I should just mention, I work for California Watch, and we didn't really explain that in the beginning. I actually worked for the San Francisco Chronicle on the editorial board and other capacities for many years, and then we've set up this new venture to cover California at the time when all these Sacramento bureaus are being shrunk or closed down altogether. And we're based at the Center for Investigative Reporting in Berkeley. So actually this question relates to that. Question from the audience, and please submit your questions and we'll try to get in as many as possible. Okay, so the first question, do you think that all big media such as the New York Times or Wall Street Journal are bad? Or do they still serve an important purpose, particularly in regards to investigative reporting?
Absolutely. They're incredibly important, and the farthest thing I can imagine from bad, certainly they have their failings. They made mistakes in the run-up to Iraq, and they make mistakes of omission and poor perspective, like any outlet, frequently. However, that's not really the point. The real problem that we face is less about them and more about the fact that that's not where most Americans are getting their news. The vast majority of the latest Pew numbers, I didn't include it in my speech, in 2000, the number of Americans who said that their primary source of news and information was commercial television was 74%. Over the following 10 years, up until last year, that number, actually it was to 2009, that number only went down 5 points to 69%. So there's two problems. One, people are not getting their news from newspapers. And two, It is true, and people may be thinking this in the crowd, and it is true that newspapers do drive the news agenda, but as these papers are forced to, most of them are forced to lay off reporters, you're getting a smaller and smaller so-called news hole, and you're getting a smaller and smaller choice of stories for television and radio to use.
Okay, now I think you could have all anticipated there is a question here about WikiLeaks. How do you feel about the WikiLeaks organization, and is there a place for complete transparency in government? I'm not sure that those are related, but let me give an addendum. Is WikiLeaks a natural outgrowth to the shrinkage or the failure of the mainstream media to expose the kinds of issues and backroom dealings and so on that WikiLeaks has exposed?
Yeah. You know, this is a tricky one, but the answer is clear. The government should not and cannot censor the media. And WikiLeaks is media. It is coming through the internet, and it would be a dangerous precedent if our government, which prides itself on our First Amendment protections, would start to block and censor WikiLeaks or any other website. So the only real solution to WikiLeaks is that the government has to get its house in order and protect its secrets. But to say WikiLeaks should not exist or should be shut down would be to say that, you know, Daniel Ellsberg should not have, under any circumstances, for example, leaked the Pentagon Papers. It's the same thing, it's just a different platform.
Okay, this is kind of a related question. Small outlets have no or limited legal defense funds. What do you suggest? Example, we run a content site, social network. A member broke a detailed story about a local bank's corruption and the Fed's shutdown of that bank. Within 1 week, we received cease and desist letters threatening us personally with defamation. WikiLeaks without a budget.
That's a good question. I hate to do this at a forum like this, but I'm going to have to get back to that questioner because I do believe there are some organizations that could be helpful, and I can talk to you after the presentation, but they certainly need and deserve help.
Okay. Here's, I think, is also a central question. Do you think that the problem is more structural, as in the citizenry is not educated enough to discern between what passes for news and journalism and sensationalism?
A good question. I mean, I do think that there are three factors that we do have to be clear-eyed about. And in out of worry that my speech would go on too long, I actually cut this out of my speech. So I'm glad to whoever asked this question. I think, number one, the world is a much more complicated place than it was 100 years ago. 100 years ago, a person pretty much needed to know how to take apart their tractor and put it back together again. And there just was not nearly the volume of information coming through, and that's really difficult. Number two, we no longer, because of the, it's a catch-22, because of the failure of the media and the way it's been so polarized, if you can imagine sort of Fox News versus MSNBC, there's no basic agreement on the basic facts of the political moment. And when there's no common ground about what the actual facts are, because the facts, as brought to you by this media outlet, are so fundamentally different than another one, it's really hard to even have a starting point for understanding. And then third, I think there's a deeper crisis, and it has to do with the scarce funding of public education for decades now, where children are graduating from public education institutions without real critical thinking skills and real basic civics. And I think that too contributes to the problem. So yes, that makes a reality where it's not as simple as do good journalism and everyone will be enlightened. There's more to it.
And Josh, you were talking about the internet technology, which is has transformed totally the media landscape. But I'm wondering, and this is an issue you deal with in your organization, most people are just trying to figure out how to connect, Netscape to their TV, or just make sure they can, download the New York Times on the iPhones. But the technology is sort of a mystery to most people, highly technical, and all these battles that you are dealing with in Washington, I think most people are totally unaware of, and when they try to focus on it, it's highly complex and technical. Isn't that a problem in terms of getting people engaged in these issues?
It is.
And how do you overcome it?
Although I do have one, I have a rhetorical question back to you. And are you talking about people over 40 or under 40?
Oh, why didn't you distinguish between the two?
Yeah, I'm over 40, so I was allowed to do that. It is a problem, and it goes to what I mentioned in my remarks, which is that these are very cognitive, sort of left brain issues. But the way to get around that is to paint a clear picture to people about how these issues affect their day-to-day lives. And that you can do. The Comcast-NBC merger is going to raise costs and diminish choices for people. The problem in internet provider competition is going to make already really expensive bills that you're paying to Comcast, Time Warner Cable, Verizon, or AT&T even higher. People get that. And they also are increasingly getting the corruption that is Washington and the need for that to be exposed and the need to have viable media institutions to bring that to them. So, I mean, I think that that's part of the answer. The second part of the answer is we have to get outside of ourselves and understand that we're not going to be around in 40 years. And these debates really are about our kids and our grandkids. They're not about us. So we have to have the vision to get the world, to get our country, to get our technology and our media in the right place so that it will serve them rather than hurt them.
I just want to remind you that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest is Josh Silver, President and CEO of the Free Press, who is discussing the future of journalism and internet access. Josh, you mentioned the Comcast-NBC merger. I want to just a couple of minutes. Why is that such a bad thing? Because, in fact, you could argue that maybe this will make the whole process more efficient. You know, when I'm trying to get my internet thing and I got the cable, all these different companies, I'm dealing with five different bills every month. Isn't there an argument to be made for efficiency in this case?
No, not at all. Afraid not. You don't get a bill from NBC every month. So,
yeah.
No, I mean, this is a simple matter of The companies that control the distribution of media should not also be able to own the content, because it takes away, what people don't realize is that Comcast has to negotiate with NBC to buy the programming that it then resells to you and everyone who is listening to this program. That's how it works. And so by Comcast not having to negotiate anymore, they then set the prices and they become like a cartel and they remove that competitive pressure. That's problem number one. Problem number two is that we already have a crisis with cable. You're hearing about it today on the pages of Huffington Post, I believe, where you can't watch Al Jazeera on cable television except in three markets in this country. That is because it's the pure discretion of these cable giants as to what they run on their networks. And if think about it this way, former Vice President Al Gore started a TV network, Current TV. And he put tons of money and tons of investor money into it under the premise that he could get this channel onto cable networks and have this great channel for young people. Because of the cable cartel and their awesome power and their unwillingness to let Current onto their offerings without a massive, massive amount of payment, they were unable to do it. And Current never became what he had hoped it to be. So if a former vice president with the Rolodex he has can't get his outlet on cable, then what about us? So it's counterintuitive then when NBC could have been sold to any number of different companies. Why give it to a company that already enjoys too much power and has demonstrated time and time again, they were the only major company that's been caught illegally blocking internet content in a so-called BitTorrent case where the FCC officially sanctioned them. They blocked political ads of opponents to political allies of Comcast. They're not a nice company either, and they did nothing to demonstrate that they're worthy of one of the largest content houses in the country.
Well, this question is a perfect follow-up from the audience. As shareholders in these companies via 401ks and other retirement accounts, are we not complicit in this complex through our demands for profits? What kind of corporate pressures can we apply?
It's a good question. I mean, if it were me, this probably comes as no surprise, I would not invest in Comcast, but or AT&T for that matter. But I think that's a question everyone has to ask themselves. I mean, I think no. I think it's probably best not to invest in those companies and move your money elsewhere because there's so many other places to go. But the larger question is, I think, are shareholder actions where bulk owners of a stock of a company acting in unison, pressuring a corporate board or a corporate executive, are those effective? For the most part, I have not found them to be terribly effective. They're often talked about, sometimes done, but with very limited success. The only success I've ever really seen are organized advertiser boycotts. So when you get enough people who basically call businesses that advertise with a media outlet and say, we don't like what that media outlet's doing, please don't advertise with them. But save that, I don't think that's an effective method.
Okay, and I know that your organization, now it's a done deal, right, this Comcast NBC.
Signed, sealed, and delivered.
Just this past week, was that?
Yeah, Friday night.
And your organization indicated you're going to keep the pressure on. What actually can you do? What are your plans to try to mitigate some of the concerns that you raised?
There's not a lot we can do on Comcast NBC. Now, there's more we can do on things like net neutrality. And again, net neutrality, the rule that says it's the longstanding principle, it goes back 41 years, the age of the internet, that it's a simple idea that says the companies that bring the internet into your home or business should not be able to indiscriminately block or slow down content for competitive or economic advantage. And it's always been that way. These companies want to change that because they see a way that they can monetize the internet on two ends instead of one. Currently, they charge you, and you pay them your monthly fee, and you get internet. But if they can break net neutrality rules, they can then go to Google or ABC News or NBC News, big companies that upload large amounts of content, and say, if you want your video or your audio or what have you to move crystal clear and quickly and be very easily accessed by the Comcast customers, then you have to pay us a premium. And it's the beginning, it's the camel's nose under the tent, it's the beginning of the internet becoming like cable TV, where they control the experience, they pick the winners and losers. And you have to understand, there's a historical context here. There have been four major communications technology revolutions in the history of our country. There was radio in the 1920s, there was television in the 1950s, there was cable television in the 1970s and 80s. And each time that those technologies emerged and came onto the scene, they came with a promise of a revolutionary kind of experience where everyone will have a voice. Anybody can have a radio station. Anybody can have a TV station. It'll be cable. You'll have hundreds of channels going to your house. Anybody could do a cable show. And each time, a set of companies realized the profit potential of this new technology. And very quickly, through government policymaking, figured out a way through licenses and carriage rights and other means to sort of take control of that medium and kind of box out would-be competitors and sort of make it a much smaller set of players that were making money. Today, we have two major cable companies, Comcast and Time Warner. They own the bulk of cable connections. We have two major cell phone companies, Verizon and AT&T. Sure, there are others, but what people don't know is Verizon and AT&T have the vast majority of the spectrum, the public airwaves that they have leased from the government. So there is an increasingly consolidated number of companies that control the space.
Okay, here's a short question. What question were you or are you hoping a young person in this room would ask? That's making the assumption that the other questions weren't asked by a young person. But
a question was, why did it take me 16 years to meet you and realize that I need to become a media reform activist?
Well, let me just do a follow-up. How much activism do you see amongst young people who are really on the cutting edge and are probably most knowledgeable about this new media landscape?
It's been pretty impressive. I mean, this is one of these stories that people haven't been hearing, but it's remarkable. We had 2.5 million people send letters and make phone calls and emails to the FCC regarding net neutrality. That's a big deal. That's a lot of people. It was a big uprising. Back in 2005, we were actually able to stop a Republican House and Senate and President from moving a piece of legislation backed by the phone companies and supported by the Republican Party through a popular uprising of sorts. Earlier on, 2003, we saw a similar uprising. 3 million people contacted the FCC on media ownership issues when the Bush FCC tried to allow a large amount of consolidation in the media space. That has been impressive, although the media consolidation activism has waned as the internet has become more prominent and people feel like that's where the action is. But this is a perennial problem. And I think part of what's happening in our country, though, I think people are feeling genuinely overwhelmed and somewhat heartbroken. I think people are feeling overwhelmed by the number of sort of failures. I mean, we have a president who is operating in the system I described, who I believe is a good person, who is trapped by a system that will not, the power system will not allow him to do the right thing from a policy perspective and him and his party get reelected. That's how powerful this complex is. It's not that different from the Republican, President Eisenhower, saying that, you know, that the military industrial complex had too much control back in the 50s. What people also didn't realize is that in the original speech, it actually said the military industrial congressional complex, and he scratched it out. So that kind of power of industry lobbyists was already starting to take a seat in the 50s, but it is going to take a real awakening of activism and awareness for us to try to actually remedy this, because it is true that the odds are stacked against us. There's enormous power in Washington against reform.
Okay, just bringing it down now to a local level, what is the future of community-funded journalism? Do you see more initiatives like David Cohn's Spot Us, where people are asked to contribute by going online to various projects? And here's Michael Stoll with a free press in San Francisco, and a number of other new journalism ventures are cropping up. How important do you see that,
is the future? I think they're pivotal. They're absolutely essential. My worry is that there's not enough money, realistically, to fund them. And that's why my hope and aspiration is that we can actually create a public media system more akin to what we see in Europe and in parts of Asia, where you actually have a reasonable amount of money that can go to those kind of innovations, that a broad swath of community media could be funded through, that a local community board that is politically balanced could make those decisions and reflect local values. But I worry that without that, that there's just simply not going to be the resources to do the kind of real journalism that our democracy requires, because the hard truth is that journalism requires professionals. It requires fact checkers and editors. It requires boots on the ground. It's not something you can do, you know, after a long, hard day while you're taking care of your kid. And that is the overwhelming concern for me.
Where does public broadcasting fit into this? National Public Radio, which I think probably many people in this room listen to, has shown enormous growth. And I don't know if it's flourishing, but it's certainly successful in terms of expanding its listenership and its audience.
I think it is flourishing, and I think it's a promising spot on the landscape, because they're the only national news institution that's actually opening bureaus around the world and expanding their journalism. I think the problem that public TV and radio face is it's so dramatically underfunded. The annual appropriations for the entirety of public media in the United States is $440 million. That is It's staggering. I mean, if the U.S. government, spends, I think, five times more money on office furniture, that if we got the U.S. government just to go to IKEA, we could double the funding for public media. We spent 1,223 times more on the bailout than we did on public media, the entirety. One of the reasons for this is that our public media system was created in 1967. It was about 15 years, I believe, after to 20, I'm not sure, 15, 20 years later than in most of Europe. And so it was the commercial media preceded the non-commercial media here, and it was sort of an afterthought, an important afterthought. But as a result, it was not embedded into the political sort of zeitgeist of the United States in the way that it is in, say, England. And it's going to take a massive political campaign. It's going to take a massive organizing effort to increase funding and to compel Congress to support that. Fortunately, a visionary named Bill Kling, who runs American Public Media in Minnesota, has taken the lead of a project called 170 Million Americans. And they are a consortium of NPR and PBS stations that are finally getting together and organizing on behalf of themselves, not just to reappropriate from Congress, but to expand the amount of funding for the system. That's exciting.
I do have to ask you about some of the proposals that have cropped up in recent months about government funding that Robert McChesney and others, who I know you work with, but not necessarily just money from Washington, but putting like a you could have your newspaper subscriptions be tax deductible, and other kind of imaginative ways to encourage public support of the media, but some form of government intervention. Obviously, it's hard to imagine with given the change that just occurred in Washington. But this is something that comes up frequently. Is this an area that...
It's possible. I mean, I have two other ideas for funding mechanisms I think might be better. I keep in mind, it's a broad range. In France, 2 years ago, Sarkozy actually made an effort to get a free subscription of any daily newspaper of their choice to every single French high school student. I mean, this is an idea that would just be mind-boggling in this country. But I think the best funding ideas that I've heard for public media would be, one, taking the proceeds from the auction of the public airwaves, which are owned by you. We own those. Currently, they go to pay for the general debt. They pay for war and what have you. The idea of earmarking auctions of public airwaves to a public media fund. Another would be
How much money is involved with it? I mean, how much money
billions,
is that actually?
Billions and billions and billions of dollars. Many, many billions. It would be an easy lift. But wow. The problem is politicians have planned for the revenue from those sales of auctions years ahead of us already. Another idea would be a modest tax on the import of any electronic device that connects to the internet. So there's ideas out there, but the most important thing is it has to be a funding mechanism that gets the purse strings away from Congress, because every year members of Congress get up on the floor and say, I don't like what NPR did, I don't like what PBS did, we're not funding you. And it turns into political gamesmanship when it should be depoliticized.
Okay, a couple of questions on this theme. What media do you follow? Who's doing it right?
I think there's a lot of examples of outlets that are doing it right. I tend to read magazines. I probably shouldn't even say that with young people in the room. Earmuffs. I read magazines and I do read online. I read the New York Times. I read the Wall Street Journal. I read the Huffington Post. But I try to diversify, so that I'm getting a bunch of different perspectives. But I do think it's really a mistake to get too sucked into this silliness around the kind of bellowing television outlets, because I really think that for the most part, I almost never see serious journalism on TV.
Here's a question on Citizens United, the Supreme Court ruling. Is there a strategy, or what possible strategies could there be to get that undone or
That's a good question.
Or diffused?
This
or
is tough. So when Citizens United made their ruling, they really put reform advocates in a box because there's really only two things that can happen. One is you get you wait for a different composition of the Supreme Court and they wise up and realize the harm they've just done. That's not going to happen soon. It's a young court for the most part. The other thing is passing a constitutional amendment, the ones I mentioned in my speech, one that would revoke the rule that or the decision that corporations enjoy the same First Amendment free speech rights as people, and the other, a Buckley versus Vallejo 1976 decision that said that money equals speech. The problem is there's been 27 constitutional amendments in the history of our country, most incredibly important, but there has never been, I would dare say, 1/100th the amount of organized, moneyed opposition to a constitutional amendment as there would be to this. And I hate to say it, but I don't think it's physically possible to pass a constitutional amendment on this issue because of organized the industrial complex that I discussed and their awesome power. That's why we need to build a movement now, and we need to work on other issues simultaneously. Well, I do think we should still do that campaign to move the goalposts, so to speak, and expand the range of debate, but we also have to look at public funding of elections, universal voter registration, redistricting reform, and other measures to try to go at it from a lot of different angles.
I think this is a little related to this, and you touched on it in your talk, but audience member wants to know, what do you think of President Obama? How do you think President Obama is doing in terms of his promise to prevent, and there's a quote, excessive concentration of power in the hands of any one corporation, interest, or small group?
I mentioned that. I mean, it's terrible. And I mean, I think the problem that Obama faces is that he's hamstrung by this lobbying juggernaut. And rather than stand up and name it, and say, I'm hamstrung by this. And that's really what FDR did. If you look at what FDR said on the eve of his inauguration, I believe it was in 1939, I'm not sure, he was basically saying that very thing, same thing then. He was saying that organized corporate interests are trying to seize control of government, and we have to fight and claw and get it back from him. And I think that Obama has made a very careful, calculated decision to triangulate and try to appease the organized industrial complex. He feels that Clinton did that successfully, and he thinks that'll work for him. Time will tell, but the question is, what is work, right? I mean, we have a financial reform bill that it did some good things, but it didn't end the too big to fail problem. It didn't end the derivative problem. It didn't end the CEO salary problem. We have a healthcare reform measure that falls way short. We're seeing an increase in the number of uninsured people since it was in the last few months. So this is, he's trying, but he would do better, I believe, to name it and become part of the solution.
Here's a couple of related questions. How do I get involved? Are there any campaigns I can join or events where I can learn more?
Thank you for asking that question.
And
go to www.freepress.net. You can sign up to be an e-activist. It's free. It takes about 10 seconds. And join about 500,000 other Americans who have already done that. Again, freepress.net. And we are really starting to see it happen. I mean, that's no small thing. And we're 8 years old. We have 500,000 members. And we are really starting to see a movement emerge. And the trick is going to be to keep it going and to get more people joining and to get the momentum to continue after a couple of difficult defeats in the past month.
Here's a question related to, citizen journalism. Although the internet has provided greater access to independent journalism, should we be concerned that the lower bar to entry into this internet journalism field risks a decrease in quality of vetting and confirmation of stories? And a related one, discuss the pros and cons of citizen journalism.
I mean, I actually think Lewis probably has a better answer for this than I do, but I'll take a stab. You know, sure, There's a lot of terrible stuff on the internet. My dear father, I love him dearly, is 78 years old and got the internet just before Y2K, and he read on the internet that everything was going to go to heck on Y2K, and he bought a bunch of food and freaked out. And then I was like, Dad, everything you read on the internet is not necessarily true. And I think we've all had that moment of realizing that. But if you look back in history, if you look at the 19th century, there was far more newspapers, for example, in the 19th century in this country than there are today. And they were very diverse and very clear and honest about where they stood. There was the sort of socialist paper, there was the conservative paper. You knew what you were getting, and you figured out what worked for you, what didn't, what you thought was a bag of lies and what wasn't, and you bought that paper, and that's how you got your information. In some ways, we sort of circled back to that, where these kinds of citizen journalism, some of them are great, some of them are not so great, and you have to figure it out, and you have to figure out what are your trusted outlets and what aren't.
One of the things I just wanted to ask you to just reflect on in the events of the last couple of days, where you just see the incredible power, number one, of these new internet tools, Facebook and Twitter, which has actually been incredibly important in organizing the opposition to the government, but also in terms of news coverage.
Yep.
That has really made a tremendous, tremendous difference.
Mm-hmm.
And then the government shut it down. So the government actually sees this as enormously threatening.
Yeah.
And also tries to shut down Al Jazeera.
I think it's a really important point. And you know, at its core, the question is, should governments or corporations be allowed to flip a switch to turn off the internet, censor the internet? And the obvious answer is no. Now, it's not, you know, it's funny, I was talking to a friend of mine in government just yesterday. It's, unfortunately, it's not as easy as just passing some global accord at the UN and the problem is solved. Unfortunately, you can't control the global stage like that. But what you can do is you can set an example as a nation. And unfortunately, we just went one step in the wrong direction on this new net neutrality rule at the FCC. And so what we need to do is recognize that what happened in Egypt is actually prescient. It shows what can happen if the control of the internet, which, by the way, it was an American company that's connected to Boeing, that was actually sold the hardware to the Egyptian government that they used to turn off the internet. So we need to look at, in our own backyard, we have to look at banning the export of the kinds of technologies that allow repressive regimes to do such things. And we have to really revisit what we're doing in our own domestic policy, and we have to help, and to her credit, Hillary Clinton has been brilliant at the State Department at really promoting an open internet and really speaking down to the kinds of censorship that we're seeing in Egypt, and she should be applauded.
We're reaching the point in our program where there's time for only one last question. I'm going to try to squeeze in two questions.
Sure.
You are doing all this advocacy work around the country. Where do you get your funding? How are you supported?
Comcast. We're funded by philanthropists, wealthy individuals and foundations who have made the connection. They've been funding environmental issues to have clean air or health care to try to get health, you know, to get affordable access to medicine for people. And they keep getting beaten by K Street, and they've realized the connection to their credit. They've realized that if we don't fix this problem of journalism, if we don't create an enlightened and informed electorate, we are not going to have the political will that is going to compel politicians to do the right thing. So it's from foundations and individuals. We do not take a dime from corporations.
Last question, short answer. What is the window of opportunity for change?
Change transcends generations. And if you look back at the history of our country, and if you look back at the history of the world, it is a struggle that goes far beyond those of us in this room. And the only thing we can do is be part of the solution instead of part of the problem, and trust that the next generation will carry the torch and continue.
Well, our thanks to Josh Silver, President and CEO of the Free Press. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. This program has been held in association with the Commonwealth Club's InForum Division. I'm Louis Friedberg, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.